make sure we have a notepad.
Do you have a notepad?
You're taking notes.
He was calling me to
move. Like to have your attention.
Can I just like write everything down?
There's coffee, drinks, and snacks over here on the side. If you do snack, snack quietly. We are delighted to have with us Father Demetrios Carellas. I've gathered some biographical information from another talk that he gave us on YouTube. Yeah, but I might need to be corrected on a few points. I was taking notes as it was going, as the video was going on. But Father Demetrios is, as he says, a southern boy, originally from Savannah, Georgia. Father graduated Georgia Tech with a bachelor's degree in civil engineering and master's degree in structures. He was in the Air Force. He was a captain in the United States Air Force. Went to Holy Cross Seminary in Brookline, near Boston, Massachusetts. Graduated with a Master's of Divinity degree. Was ordained to the Holy Priesthood in 1974.
Before most of you were born.
Not me. For one. I graduated college. Father served as a parish priest. I don't have all those locations. I know you were in Chicago, you said. We first met you when you were still in Knoxville, serving at St. George Church in Knoxville, and probably several others. Then Father became the chaplain priest at Nativity of the Theotokos Women's Monastery in Saxonburg, Pennsylvania, near Pittsburgh, from 1994 to, and he just retired in February from that work as chaplain, as priest of the monastery, to spend time traveling and speaking, and we are one of the first earliest beneficiaries of that effort, though he's been doing a lot of it, but we're delighted to have him with us. Are there any corrections that I need to make? 4 children and 16 grandchildren.
Wow.
We first met at Stephen's wedding.
That's right.
At Annunciation Church in Scranton, Pennsylvania, when we were in Old Forge. And they supply 8 of those, don't they?
Yeah.
8 of the 16. And,
what's so interesting, he was my express carrier. He knew everybody's buttons and he pushed them all. Now he's a big person.
So, welcome, Father Demetrios.
Thank you, brother. I always like to begin a talk with what I call a spiritual icebreaker. It's a true story. A young man with a problem with anger. I think there's 2 passions right now that are really controlling a large majority of the people, anger and lust. We're going to talk about lust tomorrow in the sermon. But anger is a big one too. This young man, this is back in about in Greece in the 30s. He lived in a village, but he had a horrible anger problem, especially if someone criticized him or made fun of him. And finally, the spiritual father said, Yanni, that's Johnny, excuse me, Yanni, we got to take very offensive action to get you controlling your anger. And he said, yeah, I'll do whatever you say. He says, okay, from this point on, when someone ridicules you or criticizes you, you've got to say thank you very much and give them some money. We never found out how much money, but. So he did this for 2 years. And then he came to his spiritual father to get his blessing to go to Athens. Because when young men were 19, those who had any kind of knowledge would go there looking for employment. So the spiritual father gave him a blessing. And then he said, and by the way, you don't have to say thank you anymore. You don't have to get money anymore. You're cured. He said, I'm cured. He said, you'll see. Because he knew that this old sage who had the gift of discernment would sit on a rock not too far from Athens where the young boys had to come. And as they passed by, he would look in their hearts and see all their sins and just start ridiculing them. Some of the young men were so upset, they just turned around and went back to the village. They got so mad. But when this young man came up and he started criticizing him, the young man started laughing. The old man said, "Why are you laughing, son?" He said, "Well, sir, for 2 years I had to pay for this, and now it's free." He pointed to Athens and he said, "Son, that city belongs to you. That's your city, don't worry." Before we journey specifically into the talk of Psalm 50, let's hear what St. John Chrysostom says in general about the Holy Psalter and its author. If we keep vigil in church, David comes first, last, and central. If early in the morning we want songs and hymns, first, last, and central, David again. Nor is it only in cities and churches that David is famous. In monasteries, among most holy choirs of angelic armies, in the convents of virgins, where there are communities of those who imitate the Virgin Mary, in the desert, where there are men crucified to the world, who live their life in heaven with God, David again is first, last, and central. All other men at night are overcome with sleep. David alone is active in gathering the servants of God into the bands of seraphim. He turns earth into heaven and converts men into angels. And at one point in his praise of King David in the Holy Psalter, St. John just exclaims, "Oh, amazing wonder! Many who have made little progress in literature know the Psalter by heart." Let's also take a moment to remind ourselves of the all-encompassing nature of the Holy Psalter. Through these spiritual words of St. Basil the Great, now the prophets teach one thing, historians another, the law something else, and the form of advice in the Proverbs something different still. However, the Book of Psalms has taken over what is profitable from all the other books. It foretells coming events. It recalls history. It frames laws for life. It suggests what must be done. And in general, it is the common treasury of good doctrine, carefully finding what is suitable for each one. And then our great Cappadocian father seemed to be trying to take the sacred contents of the Psalter into our very souls with this comment: "It completely cures old wounds of the soul and brings speedily improvement to the recently wounded. The disease it treats, the unharmed it preserves. On the whole, it rubs out as far as possible the passions which cunningly exercise dominion over souls during the lifetime of man." In other words, beloved living icons of Jesus, the sacred content of the Psalter can provide each one of us and every other human being who desires it with a unique, all-encompassing form of soul therapy. You heard, an apple a day keeps the doctor away. Well, I think a psalm a day will help keep the evil one away. Through the intercession of St. Simeon, the new theologian, who protects this humble parish, let's now begin our spiritual journey into a page from this unique medical book, yes, medical book of soul therapy, with the writings of our Holy Church Fathers as our constant guide. Let us pray that our most beloved Panagia Her holy intercessions will permit us to unlock at least a tiny portion of the mysteries which the Holy Spirit has planted within Psalm 50, the par excellence psalm of repentance. In his book to the Romans, St. Paul says, and we know to those who love God, all things work together for good, to those who are called according to his purpose. When King David composed Psalm 50, he verified the truth of these words. Permit me to share with you some of the writings from 2 Kings or 2 Samuel in the Masoretic text that talk about the grave sins King David committed, which eventually did indeed lead to work together for good. One day, King David was on his rooftop, and he happened to see the wife of one of his true dedicated soldiers, Uriah, Bathsheba. And when he saw her, he lusted after her, and he committed adultery with her. And she became pregnant. And in order to cover up that sin, he called Uriah back from a very big battle. Well, Uriah obeyed the king, but he was a dedicated soldier. And when the king tried to get him to go to his home, here was his reply. The ark and Israel and Judah dwell in tents, and the Lord Yoab and his soldiers are encamped in an open field. I shall not go into my house to eat and drink and sleep with my wife. How can I do this? As my soul lives, I will not do this thing. So the following day, King David tried to get Uriah drunk, and that didn't work either. So then he decided, okay. He gave a note to give to Joab, and this is what the note said. Station Uriah in front of the severe part of the fight, and retreat from behind him so that he shall be wounded and die. And of course, that's exactly what happened. So after Bathsheba completed her time of mourning, he took her as one of his wives. And then a few months later, the prophet Nathan came to him. This is such a beautiful story. But the thing what David did was evil in the eyes of the Lord. And the Lord sent Nathan, the prophet, to David, and he went and said to him, there were two men in one city, one rich, the other poor. And the rich man had very many flocks and herds, but the poor man only had one little ewe lamb, which he had purchased and preserved and reared, and it grew up with himself and his family in common. And a traveler came to the rich man, and he refrained from taking from his flocks or from his herds to prepare a meal for the traveler that came to him. But he took the poor man's lamb and prepared it for the man that came to him. And David was greatly angered against the man, and David said to Nathan, as the Lord lives, the man that did this thing shall surely die, and he shall restore the lamb sevenfold, because he is not spared. And Nathan said to David, thou art the man who has done this. These words of the prophet went straight into his soul. He obviously came to the realization that he was the rich man, that the poor man was Uriah, and that the traveler was the devil. So he confessed to Nathan from the depths of his heart, I have sinned against the Lord. And it was in this spirit of repentance that the holy ruler received the grace of God to prepare this psalm. It should be noted that it took 10 months before Nathan came to expose the two sins that King David had done. And St. Gregory of Nyssa asked, well, why did he wait so long? And his response was, he should not censure him at the time when he was still intoxicated by the passion and his soul was blurred and would not accept the censure. For probably he also would have harmed the prophet, just as those who suffer from excessive illness resist the doctors and their loved ones. This is a good point to put a little sidebar. Sidebars are things that I stick in that aren't even in a note form here. Parents, godparents, friends, you have a person who's living outside the church. Yes, maybe tell them once what you're doing is wrong. But don't keep beating them up if they're not ready to hear it. But what you can do is pray. They can't fight your prayers. And let me tell you something about prayer that I learned from a holy monk who's now with the Lord. His name's Father Sabas. He happened to come to a monastery where I served, and I was in pain, and he could see it. I've been praying for a young woman who had fallen away, and she had been so close to the church. And I told him about my plight, and then I made the statement that set him into action. I said, Father Sabas, I don't think God is listening to my prayers. And he gave me one of these looks. He said, okay, Papa, I'm going to explain it to you in a way you can understand. I said, please, please. He knew it had to be simple. Because it was in Greek, and it had to be simple because my Greek isn't all that good. He said, every time that you pray for this young woman, God tries to send the prayer into her heart. And if it doesn't work because there's a wall, God doesn't throw the prayer away. He puts it in a bag that he creates just for that young woman. And every time that you or anyone else prays for her, if it doesn't go in the heart, it goes in the bag. In the meantime, God is trying, without overcoming her free will, to put a crack in that wall of passions that she's wrapped around her heart. Once the crack occurs, he withdraws all the prayers at once and sends those prayers into that heart. And I weep because 3 months later, that happened. It was so beautiful to see it. All I could think of was the withdrawal that occurred. So as long as that person is breathing, and even afterwards for that matter, but especially as long as that person is breathing, don't stop praying, but don't judge. Don't judge. You're not going to bring them back by judging. You're bringing them back by prayer and kindness. Remember that, especially you moms, because y'all's prayers are very special in the eyes of the Lord. I'm getting to the song. Forgive me for all this introduction, but I feel it's necessary to appreciate what we have in Psalm 50. We need to first of all, again, look at a brief definition of the meaning of repentance. The Greek word metanoia literally means a change of mind, but to get into the depth of it, it means a change of everything I do, from the way I turn a light switch on, to the way I make my cross, to the way I converse with people who don't care for me, the way I worship. Everything in my life has to undergo change through metanoia. This is a return to the wholeness, a return to the loving embrace of our Heavenly Father. Our Lord Jesus Christ really illustrates this with the parable of the prodigal son. Therefore, repentance is the first healing medicine for a soul that has fallen ill and has been made dead through a life based on the demonic passions. My brothers and sisters in Christ, it is the life of sin And the life of repentance resurrects the natural state and leads to the supernatural state. Listen to these powerful words of St. John Climacus, who we celebrated last Sunday, regarding repentance. Repentance is the renewal of baptism. It is the contract with God for a fresh start in life. Repentance goes shopping for humility. Repentance is ever distrustful of bodily comforts. That should give us a hint. We pretty like those bodily comforts, don't we? We need to distrust those rascals. This thing here, you know, if I could, I'd take it and go to the deepest lake and throw it in there. Unfortunately, it's got some good things too, so I got to keep it. But it sickens me that sometimes I've left the house going 2 miles and realized I didn't have it, and I went back to get this stupid thing. Physician, heal yourself. I got a lot to learn too. Repentance is a critical awareness and a short watch over oneself. And it's the reconciliation with God. And then St. Isaac the Syrian tells us repentance is given to man as grace after grace. For repentance is a second regeneration by God. It's the mother of life. It's the power of mercy open to those who seek it. Those who seek it. And then this is very important. Abba Dorotheus of Gaza reminds us that repentance is not simply an action in a moment of time, like many in the Protestant formations consider. It's a continuous manner of living. It has a sacramental character, and its result in a word the saint tells us is salvation. It's also a gift of the Holy Spirit. So it is not simply an awareness to change one's life or an awareness that I've committed a sin. It must become a continuous manner of living by placing Psalm 50 in part of our lives. In fact, the church knows that. Look what where Psalm 50 is done in services. The midnight office, orthros, 6 hour, small compline. It's also found in the morning and evening prayer rules. The lesser blessing of the waters, the great compline, holy unction. It is read in every paracleses or small supplementary canon to the theotokos and the saints. Furthermore, just before the great entrance, the priest is saying quietly the psalm as he senses the icons and the faithful. And it should be noticed that in the commentary on this psalm, written by a 5th century monk named Cassiodorus, it is mentioned that the priest would read the psalm. If you came to confession in the 5th century, after your confession, he would read Psalm 50 over you as part of your forgiveness. It's safe to say that the Christians back then knew Psalm 50 by heart. How many of us today know it by heart? Of course, the priests, we have to. I'd now like to ask Alexander to read the entire psalm, and then we're going to start looking at it verse by verse. Write your questions down, and we'll answer your questions at the end.
Have mercy on me, O God, according to thy great mercy, and according to the multitude of thy compassions, blot out my transgression. Wash me thoroughly from mine iniquity, and cleanse me from my sin. For I know mine iniquity, and my sin is ever before me. Against thee only have I sinned and done this evil before thee, that thou mightest be justified in thy words and prevail when thou art adjudged. For behold, I was conceived in iniquities, and in sins did my mother bear me. For behold, thou hast loved the truth, the hidden and secret things of thy wisdom hast now made manifest unto me. Thou shalt sprinkle me with hyssop, and I shall be made clean. Thou shalt wash me, and I shall be made whiter than snow. Thou shalt make me to hear joy and gladness. The bones that be humbled, they shall rejoice. Turn thy face away from my sins, and blot out all mine iniquities. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from thy presence, and take not thy Holy Spirit from me. Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation, and with thy governing spirit establish me. I shall teach transgressors thy ways, and the ungodly shall turn back unto thee. Deliver me from thy guiltiness, O God, thou God of my salvation. My tongue shall rejoice in thy righteousness. O Lord, thou shalt open my lips, and my mouth shall declare thy praise. For if thou hast desired sacrifice, I had given it. With whole-burnt offerings thou shalt not be pleased. A sacrifice unto God is a broken spirit. A heart that is broken and humbled God will not despise. Do good, O Lord, in thy good pleasure unto Zion, and let the walls of Jerusalem be builded. Then shalt thou be pleased with the sacrifice of righteousness, with oblation and whole burnt offerings. Then shall they offer bullocks upon thine altar.
Thank you, Alexander. Do you see right away that spirit of repentance of the king? As Father Cassiodorus notes, he says, the rule over a huge nation became his own harshest torturer, demanding from himself a punishment that he could have scarcely endured at another's command. And he reminds us, it's common practice to excuse one own sin with phony explanations. I'm sorry, but I've been past president of that club. But the powerful king chose instead to accuse himself in the sight of all. He whose judgment the people had become accustomed to fear pronounces himself guilty. How often do we try to explain our sins? Well, you know, I had to do that. We got 100 examples, because the devil is right there giving us all these examples. As I'm going along here, I'm cutting some things out because I want us to have a little time for discussion. And the psalm, according to the fathers, is divided into 5 units because of the 5 senses that we have. The senses are the doors, you know, the smell, touch, feel, see, hear. These are the doors through which the evil one enters in order to get to us. Let's look now at the first verse together. Have mercy on me, O God, according to thy great mercy and according to the multitude of thy compassions. Blot out my transgressions. The term great mercy, the prophets tell us, is an indication, whether King David knew it or not, I don't know, but it's an indication of the presence of Jesus Christ. Why? Because oftentimes we refer to him as the great mercy. So that according to great mercy is according to Jesus Christ. Right there in the very first verse, we have an indication of a prophecy. And then St. Nicodemus finds intriguing this comment by another church teacher. David did not dare to call God his God. Notice he didn't say, have mercy on me, oh my God, like he does in other psalms. In other psalms, he doesn't end to say, my God, not here. Because he feels like he lost his God because of these sins. So he's not worthy. Others are worthy to call you their God, but not me. All I can say is, God, have mercy on me. With regards to the last half of the verse, blot out my transgressions. St. Ezekiel says God, that he's beseeching God not only to heal the wounds of his sin, but to wipe out what's left, a trace of the wounds. You know, when we have surgery, say I had a big heart surgery, and there's going to be a big scar here. Same with the soul. We get healed when there's a scar. And it's very difficult. It can happen. It did in the life of St. Mary of Egypt, where even the scar is removed. And that's what King David is asking for here. St. Cyril of Alexandria explains that the word blot out, exolixon, refers to the future when Christ will take upon our flesh and wipe out all the sins in the universe. And the blessed Jerome tells us that the reason as to why King David seeks a multitude of God's compassion, because the sin, as soon as it is committed, is written in the book of God, it's written in the book of the devil, and it's written on our conscience. But my favorite patristic teaching on this verse is by that blessed monk, Hasiodorus. By the way, he's a Sicilian, so I'm sure he had to know Greek. And back then, there was a lot of Greeks in Sicily, and not mobsters. It's a little different. He says, King David sought the mercy of God, which he could not define. In the Orthodox Church, we don't want to define things. We beg God to be able to experience things. It's a big difference. He says, he could not define, but which he felt was in every way greater than his sins. Do you know one of the greatest forms of pride, what I call backdoor pride, is when we think we've committed such a sin that God can't forgive. That's a terrible thing. That's Judas. If Judas had gone to the cross and said, God forgive me, he would be in the kingdom today. But he didn't feel that anybody could forgive him. Jesus took our flesh and died on the cross, so that we could be forgiven, no matter what we did. Look at the thief on the cross. In his last moment, he heard the words that we all want to hear someday. Today, you will be with me in paradise. Cassiodorus continues, God removed the creator of the world from heaven and clothed its founder in an earthly body. You stop and think about that for a minute. He who created the universe out of nothing, and how big is this universe? Okay. The Milky Way is one of, more sidebars. The Milky Way is one of how many hundreds of galaxies, right, within the universe? Within the Milky Way, there's a hole, not a black hole, that takes light traveling at 186,000 miles a second to go 30,000 years to go from one end of the hole to the other. The one who created this universe out of nothing becomes a slave by taking on our flesh. If we believe nothing else in life, that's going to be enough to save us. We believe that. Continues. He made co-equal with mortal man him who remains equal with the Father in eternity. And for us, clothe the Lord of the universe in the form of a slave. And listen to these paradoxes that he brings up next. So that the bread itself endured hunger, the fountain of life thirsted. Strength, with a capital S, was weakened. And the all-powerful life, with a capital L, of course, suffered death. In short, what greater mercy of heart could there be than that for us, the creator should be created, the controller should become a slave, the redeemer should be sold, the exalter should be humbled, the life giver should be slain. This was the great mercy of heart, which the holy psalmist could not explain, but he truly believed that he was absolved through that mercy, which he already knew could free the human race. I believe you could understand why I took so much time to share those spirit-filled words with you. May God grant that we keep them in our hearts as an ever-present reminder of God's infinite, never-ending, and limitless love for each one of us, for this sinful and unworthy priest, and for all of you, heirs to his kingdom. As you can see, if we had spent every verse, all 20, like we spent on verse 1, we'd be here until tomorrow and next day. A lot of verses are going to go quicker, but these are very important. I felt you need to get through the old nitty-gritty, as we say in Georgia. Verse 2, wash me thoroughly from my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. This is not a repeat. There's two different things here, as you'll see. Monk Cassiodorus believes, of course, that this refers mystically to what sacrament? Baptism. So here we have in verse 2, a reference to baptism. Doing what she says, all sins, original and personal, are totally cleansed, that it restores us to the purity of Adam's and Eve before they fell into the sin of disobedience. Bishop Theodoret of Cyrus says, it's like King David was saying, you already gave me forgiveness when you sent the prophet Nathan to me, but I still have that stench, that smell of sin. Please remove that filth from me. But then St. Basil shows us the difference. Why? The king said, be washed thoroughly from iniquity and then cleansed from sin. He said that King David never fell into the sin of adultery before. They can't find any record of him ever being unfaithful. So it was foreign and uncharacteristic to his nature. So it's for this reason that the prophet had such great sorrow for committing it. But since it wasn't a passion within him, it was outside of his soul, on the surface of his soul. Therefore, simply it needed to be thoroughly washed. On the other hand, shedding blood was something common to him, right? He probably killed quite a bit of people. So the shedding of blood was within his soul. And that required a deep cleansing, washing from the sin that was outside, a deep cleansing for the inner sin. And it's the same with us. Some of the passions we commit aren't in us. The deep one is the ones we have to work on first, those big ones that are inside. And God will, if we let him, he will cleanse us. He will heal us. He will deliver us. There's an expression in Greek, asta. You just say when you don't know what to say, because it's so magnificent what God has done.
What was it saying? What was the
saying? Asta.
Asta.
Let it go. What can we do? What can we say? What can we say? How can we? I mean, I can't believe the things that the Holy Fathers tell us. This was done to make sure that he never, since this was taking of innocent blood, that he never tried to justify the taking of a human life again. And that's Orthodox. I don't know if you know this, but in the early Orthodox Church, let's say you were a soldier and you committed murder in the battles. Let's say it was in self-defense and there was repentance, if the priest could see it. He may give you a small canon, no communion, But if he sees that you're not repentant for killing these people, even though maybe you had to, as much as 3 years no communion, to show the importance of the same 58 million abortions and people justify it. How deep is that sin? And so many people, and in the soul of this nation, verse 3. I know my iniquity and my sin is ever before me. St. Nicodemus remarks that in spite of all the many cares of his kingdom, he never forgot his crimes against God. It's like he was saying, but if I fool the people and they do not learn the evils I did, nevertheless, I know how great is my sin. I see it before me day and night with the eyes of my conscience, which strikes and wounds my soul. And for a man to always remember his sins is a sign of true repentance and a reason to offer forgiveness for my sins. Another highlight points out what the prophet Isaiah was received from God as a prophecy. I am he who blots out your iniquities and does not remember your crimes. For your part, on the other hand, remember, and let us come to judgment. Tell your iniquities first, so to be justified. And finally, Monk Cassiodorus has these little axioms that he sticks in sometimes. Perfect repentance lies in avoiding future sins and lamenting over the past ones. Verse 4. Against thee only have I sinned and done this evil before thee, that thou mightest be justified in thy sayings and prevail when thou art judged. Several of the fathers bring out a very practical point. When a king commits a sin or a crime, who evaluates him? Only God evaluates him. And because King David knew that God was everywhere, he was in great sorrow, having committed such grievous sins in the presence of all creation. Of God's creation. You know, I'll never forget one time my grandson, when he was 4, he was walking down the steps and he had his hands covered over his eyes. We said, "Minor, why are you doing that?" He says, "Now you can't see me." I can't see. And that's the way we kind of act sometimes. We forget that God is everywhere present and fills all things and sees all things. One time, a desert father whose name I can't remember at this point was propositioned by a harlot off to the side somewhere where there was no people. And so he said, "Come with me, child." And he went into the market square where teams of people, just lots of people seeing everything. He says, "Okay, my child, now do whatever you want to do with me." She said, "Hunter, everyone can see us." And he said, "My child, he sees us in private. And he sees your soul, and he loves that soul." And she wept, and she repented, and she even became a nun. Because he treated her with love, he didn't treat her with contempt. Another sidebar. We have to be very careful. One of the worst sins we can commit is to judge somebody else. And one time, Abbe John the Short was with 2 of his monks. They went into the city to get supplies for the monastery. And there was this beautiful woman who was the madam of a rock. And the 2 monks were looking at her with contempt. And the Yerida was weeping. And they said, Yerida, why are you crying? And he said, my child, look at the example of this woman. If we would try to take care of our souls as well as she takes care of her bodies, then we would be close to God. So he took it as a lesson for his disciples. Judging other people. With regard to the last half of the verse, where it says, thou mightest be justified in thy saying, and prevail when thou art judged. Cassiodorus says, God's justice is so great that he wishes to be judged in the company of men. And Bishop Theodorus clarifies for us that with the words in the first half of this verse, the king is by no means saying that he did not do any wrong to Urias and his wife, having caused the death of the former and committed adultery to the latter. He's simply stating that the greatest transgression was against God himself, who had chosen him, made him king in the place of a shepherd, rendered him stronger than enemies, and showered him with a multitude of good things. Thanksgiving. How often do we thank God for all he gives us? Everything. If all things were for good, then whatever he gives us is going to be good. If he decides that I need, in order to survive, I need cancer, that's going to tear me apart physically, then it's got to be something good for me. If he decides that I lose my physical health in an accident, God forbid. Whatever these things, a loved one abandons you, whatever it happens to be, as St. Chrysostom says, these are neutral. What I do with them makes them good or bad. Always remember that. And you know what? When you try to find the good in it, you're going to find the grace that goes with that good. Not the other way. The other way, you can become a member of the pity party club, and again, a former president, I hate to say. St. Nicodemus of Ben Athos offers us the following explanation of the last part of this verse, and here we have another prophecy. You, on the one hand, made me king and glorified me so much, while I, as an ungrateful one, transgressed your laws and embittered me so much, so that I say, when you are judging yourself with me for these things, you be justified, while I, the wretched one, be condemned. Because I appeared ungrateful towards the benefactor, thus I myself are the cause of my own condemnation. The bottom line, brothers and sisters, is I'm at fault. Not God, not the other person. When someone criticizes you, as they say, don't shoot the messenger. God's sending you that criticism, and you need to evaluate it. My spiritual father told us a story one time. It's amazing the things he gets from God on the spur of the moment. There was this king who had a chancellor that hated his guts. And he wrote a book with all the bad qualities of the king. And the king got a copy of the book. And he went into seclusion for 2 weeks. And everybody thought when he comes out, going to cut off the chancellor's head. No. He thanked the chancellor. He said, some of the things I disagree, but many of the things you said are true, and I need to change them. So if somebody comes and says, you're a very inconsiderate person, that's a message. Check it out in your heart. every day in our life, in the trenches of our daily life, God gives us so many opportunities to find our true identities and to embrace Him above all things. A lot of times we're so wrapped up in ourselves we don't see it. I should note too that some of our church fathers believe that the second half of this verse is a mystical reference to the passion of our Lord when He was judged and He prevailed. After being condemned to death on the cross, He freed the world. And that takes us through the end of talk one, first four verses. We're going to spend half of the talk two on the next verse, which is an awful lot of that. Well, how are we on time? What are we doing?
We're good. We're ready for a break, I guess.
Okay.
According to your schedule.
Let's have a break. What, 15 minutes?
15, you said?
15 minutes. I'll start again in 15 minutes. Talk to you.